Charlie Cray and his twin brothers were once professional boxers. Born in London's East End, they knew they'd have to fight to make their name. In 1951, they all appeared on the same bill at the Royal Albert Hall. Charlie Cray lost his bout. Reggie won easily and skillfully. Ronnie lost his temper and was disqualified. From early childhood, the identical twins were bound by bitter rivalry and fierce devotion. Their conviction for assaulting a policeman ended their mother's hopes for a boxing career for her sons. Their family believed it was fate that turned them into heavyweight gangsters.
You see, that's where it all began from when they were children, really. I mean, when they were boxing, they were very, very good. They won everything. People thought, if I could beat Reggie and Ronnie, even when they were children, then we'll have a name. And they never did win. So they kept winning, and as they got older, the same thing happened. People wanted to put the twins back on the floor. And so as it went on, it got worse, obviously, the violence, and they kept winning. And that's how it all began. They weren't looking around to be Jack the Lads or be villains. It happened.
Ronnie and Reggie grew up in the post-war East End with its tradition of street violence and strong sense of community. The twins used both to increase their power. They bought their mum a local pub. The Krays worked hard to appear as local boys made good. But they were murderers and extortionists. They made sure cameras were on hand to help them gloss over the dark side of their activity. The twins killed people in cold blood, but the images that remain in the public's mind are of Ronnie and Reggie giving money to charity, of Reggie posing with the stars, of Ronnie hobnobbing with politicians like Lord Boothby, and the twins immortalised by the fashionable photographer David Bailey. But in the underworld, the twins were known for what they were. And as in their early boxing days, their reputation preceded them.
Obviously, once you start getting a reputation, I mean, you stand on Bow Corner, you've got the reputation as a game boy. So you get someone down from Roman Road crowd, or Stratford, or Poplar, and you have a battle there, or you go and visit Mile End, or whatever, same thing. To be told that their twins are taking their own was a sort of, well, something to be proud of. You know. It could have gone either way. I went the wrong way.
Big Albert Donahue joined the firm after one of the twins shot him in the back of the leg. This was after the Krays had branded a friend of Albert's on the face with an electric poker. It was a punishment for some perceived slight against the twins, and when Albert dared to speak his mind, he became their next target.
Jewish guy, so he's got a blue chin anyway. He hasn't shaved because he's got these, he's been branded with electric poker, you know, the wire lighter things. And we were trying to get it out of him who done it, but he wouldn't say who done it. So in the end, I got fed up with him. I said, well, if somebody done that to me, I'd blow their head off. And that was it. I walked away. If I'd known it was running, I wouldn't have changed my mind, but I'd changed my mouth. You know, I wouldn't have said it. As soon as I walked in the pub, someone said, here he is. And everything sort of hushed. You know. I stood at the bar, got a bottle of light out. And in them days, you always kept the bottle because it's an innocent weapon. And I felt these people drifting away from me. And I thought, oh shit, it's off now. And then, bang! And I turned around, and here's the other guy going like that with an automatic pistol.
Albert refused to tell the police which twin had shot him. This made him worthy of joining their firm.
They said that when your leg's better, come and work with us. In the meantime, we put you on a pension. I think it's 15 quid a week pension, which was, I suppose at the time, near enough average week's wages. You know. So that was it.
That was the moment you were on the phone?
Yeah. Signed up.
Albert Donoghue became a soldier at Fort Valence, the nickname for the Krays family home at number 178. Like much of the East End, it's now been demolished, but even in its notorious heyday, it hardly resembled the fortress of Ronnie's fantasies. Here, he and his brother held court and presided over the firm's board meetings. From the front room of the Two Up, Two Down, they ran a criminal empire. The first time he set eyes on Ronnie, it was obvious to the policeman who was eventually to jail the twins that he was playing the part of an American gangster.
It was a summer's evening, and I realised that a car had drawn up immediately outside the door and looked outside. It was a big American-type car, and a guy stepped out of the car, put with his hand in his pocket, as though he had a gun in his pocket, and he sort of swept the street, looking up and down and making sure that there was no one inside, and then gave a signal, and the back door opened, and out stepped Ronnie Cray. And I was amazed because he was dressed for all the world like a 1930s Chicago gangster. He had a long, long cashmere coat that reached to his ankles, tied in a loose belt at the waist. His hair was greased and parted, and he wore his glasses, and then he swept across the pavement and into the pub, and he looked to me like Al Capone without his fedora.
Many were prepared to obediently follow the Cray twins' lead, but those were the days when the stands at Hackney Dog Track were packed with punters. Now a few loyal supporters remain, among them Tony Lambriano, clinging to the values of an age when the odds were stacked in favour of villains, and no one stopped to think about the consequences. Lambriano's loyalty cost him his liberty. He spent 15 years inside for his part in one of the Krays' murders.
When you talk about fear, what is fear? It's an imagination of something. That's what fear is. I've seen frightened people, yeah. I mean, we've all done it. Every one of us has terrified someone in some way. But I think we saw it as a way of, like, earn a living. I mean, you can go and go to a lawyer, for example, solve a problem. But if you went to someone like the twins, their word was enough. I mean, the problem ended. It's proved time and time again. Their name was enough. They didn't need a firm. There was a firm, the two of them on their own. They never need a firm. See, the twins had to live up to this reputation. Bear that in mind. And what I mean by that is, what people want them to be, they had to be, I suppose, if I look back on it that way. So they had to be good at whatever they'd done, and believe that, you know, they were good. The best I ever saw.
Well, I was known as Reggie's man. I mean, he didn't use words like minder, bodyguard, that sort of thing. Just, I was Reggie's man.
Did you have lots of money in your pocket?
Well, apart from the twins' pension, if you did any business with them, if you actually went on a bit of business and there was money involved, you got a slice of that. Plus, I could eat and drink for nothing, and I could get my clothes made to measure next to nothing. You needed a car, you just went to the car site and frightened the governor and pulled one off the front for a couple of weeks and run it into the ground. Hardly any expenses. I was then put in charge of collecting the weekly payments from different clubs and places. And from that, I would pay out the pensions. I'd be told who to pay. And if somebody was out of favour, they wouldn't get paid that week. You know? There was no fabulous fortunes and thousands of pounds and all.
Protection was one of the firm's main sources of income. People paid up because they were afraid. The twins couldn't afford to let their reputation for violence slip. That reputation usually ensured that their victims didn't complain to the law. Detective Inspector Nipper Reed had to sit back and wait for witnesses who would dare to speak out against the gangsters. In 1965, some 3 years before he finally arrested them, he thought he had a breakthrough. London club owner Hugh McCown complained to the police about the protection racket. The twins were charged with demanding money with menaces. They wanted 50% of the profits from his club, The Hideaway. The people who knew the twins and their methods were not surprised when they were acquitted after witnesses retracted their evidence.
There's no question about what prevented witnesses giving evidence to suggest that the Krays were involved, and that was terror. Just absolute fear and terror, because the Krays generated that by their threats, by intimidation, and by their violence. People were openly saying, they won't be long. They'll get away with it. They'll get out. And so it happened. This gave them even more confidence, even more arrogance, even more certainty that they were the kings of the underworld in the East End and that nothing could change that.
This is BBC Television.
The twins used the press to capitalise on their release.
How much does the trial cost you?
It's cost us roughly £8,000.
And how do you feel about that?
No, so then I like the idea to spend that money for no reason, for you know.
Does it leave you broke, or how does it leave
you? It doesn't leave us broke, but at the same time it's a lot of money to have to pay out when money's innocent, you know.
A lot of people have got the impression from this trial that Clubland, London, is very tough. Do you think it is? You run a couple of clubs.
Well, in all clubs you get an occasional drunk, you know, and sometimes have to be flung out, and that's why there's dormer in that. I suppose it's like Clubland all over the world, really, just the same as... I don't suppose it can be that bad. I think one go to them, really, would they?
Well, Ronald, what do you think about Clubland in London?
Well, I think most clubs are very respectable, you know, and I don't think there's any trouble at all in them, except occasionally.
In the East End, the twins' victory over the law only increased their power to dispense their own vicious brand of justice.
You knew if you were doing wrong, and you knew if it warranted some sort of comeback. So you were expecting it. And I've known cases where people were upset when they didn't get seen to, because it made them feel small, insignificant. You know? A scarf, a chip mark, they would wear them with pride, you know. Look at me, I've got a cut. It was a sign that you were a tough guy. First of all, the guy would be kidded to, made to feel easy. All right, will you drink in, that sort of thing. Then one would walk away from him that way, one would walk away from him that way. And then when everything was right and everybody was out of the way, they would just spring the guy. Is cut. They don't feel it. That's the first thing they do, is they look, they see the blood. And a lot of people, because they're bleeding, they're beaten. Other people, they get angry when they see their own blood, you know. But most people, as soon as they think they're bleeding, they go, woof. Especially when they couple with the opposition, of course, you know.
Come on, everybody, tonight's the party night of the Astor Club. Come on! Enjoy yourself, it's better than you think. Enjoy yourself, while you're still in the mood, they cheer.
In the 60s, crime was tinged with glamour. Celebrities and villains rubbed shoulders at the Astor Club just off Berkeley Square. But violence was never far beneath the veneer of respectability. One night at the Astor, the chief henchman for the rival Richardson firm, Mayor Frankie Fraser, was entertaining the fugitive Scottish murderer Jimmy Boyle. Insults were traded when Cray associate and bank robber Eric Mason arrived on the scene.
And I walked in with these two friends of mine, and one of the Scots guys said something about my friend's broken nose, and my friend knocked him out. And all hell was let loose then. So the Richardson's, Fraser and all that felt that they had to make one against us because of their showing discourtesy to their friends from Scotland, and that's how it started. So all of a sudden a few knives come out, axes and one thing and another, and I jumped in, pulling people off my pal.
Police were called, got out the back door, and bumped into Mason outside on the pavement. And he said, Reggie and Ronnie won't be pleased with what's happened here tonight. This was nothing to do with me, or even with them for that matter. And with that, I just bundled him in the car and kidnapped him.
Was he injured at all?
Well, if he wasn't injured, then he must have been the Invisible Man. Of course he was injured. With a chopper.
Injured where?
Round the head, everywhere.
They overpowered me and got me into this workshop where Fraser pulled a chopper and hit me on the head with an axe. But I put my hand up, and my hand, and that scar there, my hand was pinned to my head. I couldn't move the hand. And they tried to chop that hand, and you see them scars there, that's where they tried to chop the other hand. And I was making remarks, he won't ever fight again.
He really got what he deserved. And that day, he wasn't a bad fellow, as it happened. So, you know, in that sense, he never went to the police afterwards or anything like that. No, or anything. But on that particular night, he was bang out of order.
Well, I thought I was dead. You know what I mean? I see lights and all that. I must have been come to with lights in the operating table or something, because I had 370 stitches, 3 fractures in my skull, and I was in a pretty bad state.
Mason and Fraser's fight took place as the Underworld was bracing itself for all-out war between London's two major firms, the Krays and the Richardsons. This never happened, because in March 1966, the Richardsons got involved with a local gang in a gunfight at the Mr. Smith's Club in Catford. One man was shot dead. As a result, most of the Richardsons were either under sedation or under arrest.
The Richardsons were now broke up. Some were in hospital, some were in Nick. Cornell was a loner, and he's come over to our territory. It was an insult. Ronnie took it as an insult. To us, Cornell was a finished man. He was beat. He had no backup. You know. Any one of us would have faced him in a pub, but it wouldn't have come to killing the man. There was no reason to kill him.
George Cornell was the only key member of the Richardson's firm still on the loose. He was a violent man who'd taken part in their torture sessions. He crossed the river into Cray territory to drink at the Blind Beggar pub. Legend has it that he called Ronnie Cray a fat poof. What's certainly true is that Cornell was afraid of no one. The pub was less than a mile from Fort Valence. Cornell was with his friend Albie Woods, who now talks publicly about that night for the first time.
The pub was completely empty. There wasn't a soul in there. So we walked right the way along the long bar, and as it bends round at the end, there's a partition there, and it's curtained by the partition, which led into the public park. George sat in the corner, you know, we're back towards the partition. I sat on the corner, facing him.
The Underworld grapevine was quick to inform Ronnie Clay of an enemy presence on his manor. He set off with his driver and a 9mm Mauser automatic.
5 minutes went by. Maybe 7 minutes. All of a sudden, George says, look who's there. Then I realised that someone had stopped behind me. George was sneering at him. And at that instant, bang, the shot was fired. All I could see was one massive, big, you know, flame of smoke, something like, you know, blue. couldn't see you all then, you know. Then I slid off my stool to duck behind the bar, and then down he came. He wasn't unconscious, he was still conscious, he was sort of moaning. So I was just saying to him, all right, George, I'm with you, like, you know. And I put a cushion underneath his head, you know, made it sort of make him comfortable. He had a hole in the face, and it was pumping out onto me, you know, just pumping all the time. And I didn't see any other, you know, wounds or anything, like, you know. I was wearing a blue mohair suit with a collar and tie. And when I looked at myself, I was absolutely saturated in blood. And I just took the coat off, put it on the seat, and jumped in my car and drove to the first telephone box that I came to phone his wife, Ollie.
All the police were able to get on the night was some scene of the crime photographs. Albie Woods maintained he didn't see the killer, and the other witnesses went to ground. Cornell was still alive when he arrived at the London hospital. The firm left the manor for a pub in Walthamstow. In Ronnie's mind, they were his troops, and he was their commander.
Getting bulletins from a nurse in London hospital, and she said, this guy's not dead. He'd been shot in the head with a 9mm bullet. He's still alive. It was early hours of the morning, anyway, when we heard, came of the news that he is dead. And a cheer went up in the pub. Imagine that. The colonel cheered first, and then every others join in. Look, I'm with you, sir, you know. Cheer because a man's dead, and dead, that's it. That's the sort of life it was.
Their names were Ronnie and Reggie. They were twins. And as they grew, they came to understand the power of fear. They were the Krays, and their story is terrifying because it is true. Gary and Martin Kemp star as the Krays.
Who loves you, eh?
The media loves the Krays. They've made more money selling their story from prison than they ever made as gangsters. In the razzmatazz that surrounds the twins to this day, their cold-blooded murders have been sanitized. People who were children during the Krays' reign of terror campaigned for their release. Back in the 60s, once the twins' violence had escalated to murder, hardened members of the firm realized they were completely out of control. They might even turn against their own.
Twins wouldn't send a stranger to get you, because they know you'd either do the stranger or you wouldn't show. So the person who's going to come for you is your partner. So we had a little arrangement that if he used my first name, Albert, that's a warning, and vice versa. You know. Which, like, to anyone accompanying him, if he knocked at my door and said, it's only me, Albert, no problem, don't sound like a signal, but it is. You know. And that way I'd come flying out the window with a shooter in the end or something.
As the instinct for self-preservation took over, the firm's main men considered murdering the twins.
When something would happen, it would be, we could have done that for that bastard last night. Yeah. We used to call them Gert and Daisy, the two, Reggie and Ronnie. But Ronnie was vulnerable because when we're going somewhere in the car, he had to sit in the passenger seat. People with Ronnie just sitting behind him, just take him through the tunnel and bow, he's gone. Chuck him out the other side or take him somewhere and bury him, burn him. Well, the problem, as we saw it, was not the twins, it was after that. If we want to carry on, we've got to build up a new fear. Plus, we've got to handle a very likely arrest for the actual murder of the twins. But they were definitely as much on the list as we were.
Murder is seen as a solution to a problem. Frank, the mad axeman Mitchell, became the twins' next problem.
Initially, they decided to help him escape from Dartmoor Prison. Anyone who could lift 2 15-stone men at arm's length would be useful muscle on the firm. Mitchell had spent 18 years inside for various crimes of violence and had been certified insane. Even at high security Dartmoor, he was allowed to wander off from outside working parties to visit the local pub because he was so difficult to control. The Krays thought it would boost their gangland reputation to help him campaign for a release date for his life sentence. The first step was to spring him from the moor.
Nobody believed it would happen. So when it was discussed, they was all, I mean, no, I don't even know where the moor is. Where's that? Near Scotland? You're all laughing about. Anyway, like an idiot, I mentioned I'd been evacuated to a place called Ashburton, Devon, which is on the edge of the moor. Oh, well, you know where it is. Oh, shit, I'm in it now. So it's decided that me and Mad Teddy Smith, and we go and pick him up. That's all it was, a pickup. Didn't have to break him out or anything like that. No sirens going and all that rubbish. I thought we've got no chance here. Anyway, we found the only phone box in Dartmoor to park by. Mad Teddy Smith is making a moody phone call to look good to any possible passers-by. I looked up and Mitchell's come round this bend in the road. Sugar, couldn't believe it. Here he is. Now we've got to get him in the car. We've got clothes for him and all that. Get this bloody great Tarzan type jungle knife he's made up. Off him, throw it all away, drill into him, there'd be no violence at roadblocks. Anyway, we were in London before it came on the news.
Police believe that the escaped Dartmoor prisoner Frank Mitchell is still on the moor. Mitchell, who's 37, has been described as the most violent criminal in Britain.
Because it wasn't unusual for Mitchell to slip away, it was several hours before the alarm was raised. The twins had not anticipated the extent of the publicity that would surround the escape. Mitchell wrote to the Times and sealed the letter with his thumbprint. He said if he got a release date, he would give himself up. But he never got that chance. The twins began to realise that Mitchell was a liability. In the underworld, it was an open secret that Reggie and Ronnie were behind the escape. They'd risk arrest just by visiting Mitchell at the Barking flat they provided as his hideaway. When the Mad Axemen started to get restless, they sent a nightclub hostess called Lisa Prescott along to keep him company.
Frank fell in love with her, that was it. Really. Then he started saying he wants to get out of this place, he wants to move around, he wants to circulate. Now, when this was relayed back, right, that was it. He signed his warrant then. He's now become dangerous. And the next thing I know, I'm pulled up to get him out of the flat, separate him from the girl, get him out of the flat, deliver him to a van.
Donoghue was told the van would take him and Mitchell to a country hideout. He knew what would happen, but not when. Inside the van were underworld hitman Alfred Gerard, South London villain Jerry Callahan, and the much-feared armed robber and gangster Freddie Foreman. None were members of the Cray firm.
Came down the path of this flat into the Barking Road.
see the vein over on the left, like a Thames vein, or an Atlas, I think, in them days. So there's a guy in the pavement, he opens the door. Two guys sitting on the wheel casing on the left, they said, "You sit over there, Frank, on the right wheel casing." As he slams a passenger door, these two guns just open up. Bow, 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 bow. Mitchell's on his knees and can see him hitting him. And he just fell back to a double back on his own legs. Now we've done the first right. We're going to do a right, back where we started. And he started groaning. So one of them, bang, 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 three times in the, around the heart. You could see his shirt jumping. Quiet. Now we're coming up, back up to the main road. He starts groaning again, or whether it was some physical, what do they call it, reaction when he's dead. Anyway, the gun went under his ear and bow, that was the last one. Now we're at the main road, so I said, right, stop here. I couldn't see how the strange firm had just done this business in front of me, a middleman. And I'm not dead. Common sense told me I should be next. And I was waiting for a bullet. And I said, right, drop me here. I've got to go back. And I'm just talking, just to out the back door. I'm still waiting to be done as I walk away from that thing. You know, the smell of gunshots, and it was Cordite gunpowder, whatever it was, but I had a big old Crombie overcoat on. I got out of there and I had to, it was cold night, but I had to walk along with it wide open, get rid of the stink of this. Mm. Plus I was sweating like a pig, I tell you. Because that hair's on the back of your neck, it was on the whole up the back of my head they were standing up. I was expecting a bang any minute. Mm.
Reggie's trusted lieutenant walked back to the flat where a terrified Lisa Prescott was waiting. She had heard the shots that ended Mitchell's 11 days of freedom. Albert gave every surface of the flat a wet and dry wipe to get rid of any fingerprints. Then he rang the twins, who told him to bring Lisa over. She was prepared for the worst.
On the way there in the car, the girl said something I'll never forget. Connie Whitehead's driving the car, and he's laughing and joking. He's normal self. He doesn't know what's happened. So she said, "Will you promise me when it's my turn that you do it?" I said, "What are you talking about?" She said, "And I think you'd do it quick. Not like him."
The pair were driven to the firm's Christmas party. It was the day before Christmas Eve. Lisa managed to convince the twins she wouldn't talk. Ronnie was more interested in what Donahue had to say.
Now, Ronnie Krays here, and I've got to go over this detail by detail to him at least half a dozen times. His eyes are shining. Tell me again. Oh, God. And then they all cleared off, and I stayed the night there with Lisa. I think we were both in need of a little bit of comfort. You know. And I was still nervous. I think it was a week later when I was asked to deliver the £1,000 to Foreman's Pub. So I thought, what better? You know, they've had a think. So that night I was told up to do it. If that guy had coughed, I'd have shot him. To me, it was common sense that I should go. And I'm pretty sure that since they've, if one of them, or both of these, them two are watching this, I bet they're nodding, saying, yeah, we should have done. There you go, lucky.
Frank Mitchell's body has never been found, and no one convicted of his murder. Detective Inspector Nipper Reed based the Krays investigation at Tintagel House, south of the Thames near Vauxhall, well away from Scotland Yard, where the twins were rumoured to have friends. Everyone took the influence of the Krays seriously. 18 months after Mitchell's disappearance, the police brought in Lisa Prescott for questioning, and she was still very much in fear of her life.
When they came over Lambeth Bridge, she realised they were going away from the yard and not towards it. In fact, they were, of course, going to Tintagel House. And so she leapt out of the car, and one of my officers fell out and followed her, and she just stopped her jumping over the bridge. She was about to kill herself. She believed completely that these lads were from the Krays and that they'd been sent to do away with her.
This tremendous power to terrify was the Kray twins' greatest weapon.
Just when you just have to glare at some people when they shoot themselves. Well, that was one of his favourite tricks. He would sit in a pub or a club where we were, and people would be brought in for various reasons, and he could just sit there and stare at this person for half an hour, and that person would, he hasn't said a word to him, and that person's gone away and thoroughly cowed, you know. He'd been told off without a word. That was how much fear that he generated.
In the warped world of the twins, their next victim, Jack the Hat McVitie, caused his own death.
And when people go into the McVitie murder, if ever a man thought about his own death, if you want to put it that way, or if ever a man was the cause of his own murder, it is a case that stands at his shoulders above everyone else. And I'll explain why. He had outrageously challenged him time and time again. He had picked up phones throughout the East End pubs and that, attempted to phone them up and mug them off. He was warm, knock on the head. He had turned up at Marie's pub with a shotgun, drunk and pilled out of his head, knowing one of them was in there and threatened to shoot him. They got to hear about these things. Now, you must remember, in their position, how far could they let him go?
The twins never provoked a row in their life. They were provoked. They either got killed or they retaliated. I mean, they didn't want violence. It was put to them all the time. It's hard to understand who you've been there and seen.
Jack McVitie, a small-time villain often out of his head on pills, was invited to a flat in Evelyn Road in Hackney on the 28th of October 1967. The twins had commandeered the place for the night, ordering the girls who lived there to leave. Jack the Hat, called Tony Lumbriano, was taken into a party.
The four of us in a car, in his car, it was a Zodiac, two-tone, Mark II. There's me, there's Jack the Hat driving. We arrive at every road, we park down the side, we get out and we walk into the door. There's a long passage and down a flight of steps. As we walk in, I was the first one in. Now, I was very, very surprised to see Ronnie Kray there, number one. Reggie walked over to me, and Jack was directly behind me.
Jack the Hat had been lured into a trap.
Reggie pulled him from behind and tried to shoot him in the head, but the gun failed to go off. And he kicked it a few times, and then he sat down, and there was a bit of talk. What have I done? And then Reggie took him. You know what he's done yet. Now it comes to an end. He stood up and walked out of the window, and he punched the pane out of the window. That was when it was said he tried to die through it. He never died or attempted to die through that window. He punched it in sheer frustration that he had been set up. Now, the next thing that happened, I turned around and there's a carving knife, a normal carving bread knife in his hands, that obviously someone had picked up in the kitchen. And the next thing, it was over. I saw it, I think he stabbed him twice, three times around. I didn't actually see it because I turned away. And next thing, he's lying on the floor. Now, it was said that Reggie pinned him to the floor with a knife. That, through the throat, total, never happened. Could you imagine that happening? What, I mean, the fact that he'd been stabbed three times, personally, I think the first one killed him. That's what I think happened there. I mean, it was over, it was done. Now, no one knows what to do. It's happened. We've got an event on our hands. What amazed me? The twins said, give it to each other. Just like that. And they went.
Jack McRitchie's body has never been found.
Obviously, I regret a life being lost. I mean, you must do that, whatever way you look at it. Like, there's a point there at that, isn't it? You want a grass or anything like that. It's just his way of life clashed with ours.
Men who could casually dismiss murder were recruited by the twins and moulded into a firm that could swing into action and cover up the evidence of their crimes.
My job is to decorate. And these girls have been left to clear up the pools of blood, not just spatters, puddles. And they have to mop it up and keep emptying their base and start again. And then I had to paint, dig out some bits of plaster, fill, tar paper, then wallpaper, the whole place inside that.
The police didn't even know there'd been a murder until 6 months later, when an informant told them. Around the hastily repaired window and beneath the layers of wallpaper, they found traces of blood. Those close to Reggie knew his twin had been pressurising him to commit murder.
Christ, I couldn't understand it. The guy had never done him any harm, you know what I mean? He was just a hill popper, ladies' man, life and soul to party. I know it was just Reggie's answer to Ronnie's Cornell. When Ronnie got drunk and he was heavy on his pills, he would be screaming at him, "You cowardly bastard, I've done mine. Now it's time you skinny slag, about time you done yours." Simple as that. There's no secret about that at all. You ain't got the guts.
Exactly 1 year after the murder of Jack the Hat, the Cray twins were arrested after a night out at the Astor Club. Armed police broke down the door of the council flat where they still live with their mum. A total of 26 people were arrested as the police rounded up the firm. They had believed they were untouchable, but their power depended on fear, and now there was no one left to enforce it. One by one, witnesses came forward to testify against the Krays. Ronnie boasted that if he hadn't been in court, he'd probably have been with Judy Garland. But his days of mingling with celebrities were over. For murdering Cornell and McVitie, the twins got life with a 30-year recommendation.
It was a reflection of what the judge felt was the right penalty for the crimes that they'd committed. I think he saw them for what they were, as arrogant, dictatorial, leaders of a gang that had warped the society of the East End, had committed brazen and quite gratuitous murders without regard to the lives and the considerations of other people, and they terrorised the whole of an area of London.
The sentences for the 10 members of the firm totaled 159 years. This is what Ronnie and Reggie saw as an armed convoy drove them to Durham Jail after the trial. Ronnie is unlikely to ever be released from Broadmoor, and Reggie has been continually refused parole.
Their arrogance is still apparent. They've both written two books. There is not one sign of repentance or remorse. In fact, they're both savour the fact. Ronnie Cray talks about the delight that he still enjoys at remembering how he shot Cornell. Reggie Cray says he's no regrets about having stabbed to death poor Jack McVitie. So there was no question of any remorse. There was no feeling that, yes, we were wrong, we were bad, we were evil. They've never said that.
For the twins and their supporters, there's still too much at stake to admit that they were wrong. If they deny their past, they'll have nothing left. Tony Lambriano, is still on licence for the murder of Jack Mahat. He's proud of the fact that he never grasped, even though it meant 15 years in jail.
All right, don't go, mate.
I was a villain, I was a criminal. So I'm not going to stand and point the finger or blame anyone for my downfall. The choice was mine. And at least I can stand and look in the mirror and say, oh, I never point the finger or put them away in any way whatsoever. I can live with them. That's not what I'm about. And if anything you can come out of this pride with, that is something that I never put them where they are today or any other men involved.
But the twins had no more respect for the code of the underworld than they have for the laws of straight society. On remand in Brixton, they ordered other members of the firm to take the rap for their murders.
Ronnie turns to me, he said, don't worry about it, the case, he said. What we're going to do, not would you mind, what we're going to do, we want you to take Frank Mitchell. I said, no. Oh, he said, and we'll take all the frauds and violence. Shit, you can get out of that, you know, just frighten a few people, they don't give evidence. So I said, no. And now I get the benefit of the eyes. Now, that's it, I know, I've crossed the line now. I'm now an enemy.
Donahue wasn't prepared to do time for a crime he had not committed. He told the police everything about the murder of Frank Mitchell. But no one was convicted because the judge felt the evidence of a former member of the firm could not be trusted without corroboration.
Once we get to trial and I start giving the evidence, then everybody stands back in amazement. Wow, look, here's this former member of the firm. He's spun right round and now he's Queen's evidence. They don't know anything about the reasons. They don't know why. And they say, supergrass. And I think that was the birth of the phrase supergrass, and that was it. They became supergrass number one, I think. I ran out with 2 years, and this obviously set a lot of people thinking, wow, and a lot of them bought diaries out of that, I think.
2 years for murder instead of life. The underworld got the message that being supergrass paid off.